right. Thank you so much for introduction. Thank you for coming here. It's a pleasure to give a talk to this audience. I'm actually first time. It's the first time for me to be in Russia and, of course, in Moscow at the same time. So thank you, Andrei, for inviting me here. So indeed, I'm going to talk about modeling complex networks. But before that, let me just mention a few words about myself. So not too long, don't worry about that. But I call myself pure mathematician. So my PhD is in computer science and mathematics at the same time. But I would call myself definitely pure mathematician instead of computer scientist. So I'm interested in graph theory, which is a fancy name I gave for networks. But I also like probability, so I like random structures, algorithms, and so on. And also like to model the real network or model the mechanisms that we observe. So I like all those three things and try to combine them in my research. But I'm doing mostly, you know, most of my time I'm sitting in the office trying to prove theorems. But of course, surprisingly maybe, at least for me, the industry partners really like what we are doing, and I also have some applied research projects as well, but I'm kind of, it's like an outcome of this pure mathematics interests, and not the vice versa. So I was never, you know, I never cared too much about applications, but surprisingly, those things that we do make a lot of sense for applied world. So I started working with companies as well, and also. I work with social scientists, so that's also something new to me, but also they try to understand the mechanism happening in the real world. And you know, if you want to impress your president of the university or the dean, you know, working with social scientists makes a lot of sense, because, you know, in computer science or mathematics, you rarely publish in Science or Nature or some highly prestigious journals. It's very difficult to do that, at least for me. But working with social scientists makes it easier, because, you know, these things are important for them, and they publish in those high prestigious journals. In any case, so that's just to give you a background and maybe tell you a little bit about my applied side, since I'm guessing, you know, since we are in Yandex, most of you probably care about applications. So in the applied world, I work with companies such as, say, the Globe and Mail, which is the main newspaper in Canada, or the BlackBerry that you probably know as well. We also work with Microsoft Research. I visit Seattle mostly, but also in going to Boston, and Google, and Yandex, I guess that's the first time, but maybe in the future we'll also start working on some projects together. So that's the in the past. So currently I'm working with the government of Canada, mostly on hypergraphs, and little companies in Canada as well, and we're about to start a project with the Bell Lab, which is based in the US, and I'm not sure you recognize this company, but it's also a very prestigious, very strong company in optimization. They want to optimize their schedules that they're doing for others. So that's just a little background by myself, mostly focusing on applied stuff, which is kind of a little bit strange to me because, you know, like I said at the beginning, I wouldn't call myself an applied person. So we are doing, you know, this is a buzzword, but everyone believes we are in the era of big data, so we are surrounded by networks. And what we try to do is, of course, try to use them to take advantage for the company or for ourselves. But maybe what's different in my research is that I always try to see some networks, some graphs in those creatures. So many people just approach this just from purely, say, text-oriented point of view, but I always try to find networks there. So of course, sometimes it's very easy, like you've seen that picture probably many times. If we want to mine, say, the internet, the web graph, then our nodes will be web pages. So those are nodes or vertices for me. And then of course, you have hyperlinks, and those are the edges of my network. And if I want to find something in the network, like for example, you know, PageRank, I want to do something with these networks, then that's kind of naturally given to me. But of course, you know, it's not just the one network we care about. Maybe you care about Facebook, so we work with companies like Twitter or Facebook on those things. And that's also kind of naturally given to you. But you can think about any social interaction. So talking to social scientists, it doesn't have to be something explicitly given to you. Maybe it's a net. Maybe it's a social interaction, namely, you know, people meet and talk. Like in the old days, right? Not just on Facebook, you know, there could be any other social interaction between them. Or maybe you want to say cluster all the papers. You want to extract some papers talking about I don't know, flowers. So what can you do is you go and look at the search for the text in papers, but of course also you might care about citations, or you might care about who wrote a paper with who. So maybe you would like to look at the so-called collaboration graph, where notes are corresponding to scientists and edges correspond to interactions between them. So you can have a graph or hypergraph for each paper. For example, you can put a hyper edge. So this is just, again, the snapshot of the collaboration network around Paul Erdős, which is our Lady Gaga, I guess, on Twitter. He is the most famous mathematician, I guess, so everyone tries to count how far we are from Paul Erdős. So I was born, unfortunately, too late, so I didn't collaborate with him, but I think I collaborated with 6 or 7 or 8 people that collaborated with Paul Erdős. So yeah, I'm there. I have Erdős number 2, and then there are 8 or 6 independent paths. So yeah, so for us, you know, we try to minimize, I guess, 1 plus 1 over the number of papers with people who has Erdős number 1. So that's what we try to optimize, I guess, for those that didn't have a chance to meet Paul Erdős. So you might think, okay, so there are many networks I can think of, so are they similar or not? So, you know, can we try to come up with the model that tries to capture what's going on in these networks? And of course, the answer could be yes, but I can also give a talk and say no. Every single network is different, and you have to, you know, really understand your network and what's going on there. But there are some main features that are similar in these networks. So, for example, we are large, right? So the number of nodes is huge. Also, we have the so-called small world property. So what does it mean? It means that, you know, it's a huge network, but on the other, surprisingly, people or users or nodes, or whatever they represent, are very close to each other in some sense. So some people say, oh, the diameter is log n, or maybe they say, typically the average distance is log n over log n, where n is a number of nodes. So that's kind of surprisingly low, you would guess, because, you know, like if you talk about, say, I don't know, citation graph, or if you take, for example, I don't know, like collaboration graph, why should I be close to someone working on, I don't know, flowers? It's maybe surprising. Or why on Facebook I'm so close to people in different part of the world. But surprisingly, those kind of sporadic long links can bring me very close to people that are far away from me. And also degree distribution, for example, it's very similar in these networks. Of course, there are exceptions, as everything else. But in many networks, we see, for example, power law degree distribution and you know, bad expansion and small clustering, large clustering coefficient, and so on. So there are many properties, and we can try to come up with a model that tries to capture as many things as possible. But of course, you might ask yourself, you know, why do we care about that? Why do we try to prove anything for these models? And, you know, for me, probably, it's just a nice math challenge, you know, to prove a theorem about these creatures. But again, surprisingly, maybe they have quite a bit of applications. So of course, you know, like Google or Yandex, I'm sure that you care about networks because, and models because you want to understand how the web graph changes and behaves. So we want to predict things, for example, or we want to learn the tricks how to detect communities and so on. But I guess for me, as a mathematician, I guess the most important is this one. I don't want to kind of like a very complicated black box that tries to, you know, that has maybe like 100 parameters, and if I tweak all of them, I get something similar to the real network I try to model. I don't want to have that. I want to have something very simple, but at the end of this process, I want to understand some kind of like microprocesses, some interesting stuff going on in these networks. So I don't want to be perfect. I just want to be less perfect, but just gain the intuition what's going on. So for example, like people were wondering initially, why do we have power law degree distribution in these networks? So, you know, if you sit with a piece, you know, piece of paper and try to do some calculations, it's much more natural to expect, say, exponential decay instead of power law. So if you put a graph at random, if you connect nodes at random, then, you know, by pure randomness, you wouldn't have nodes which have, you know, high degree. That's just highly unlikely. So people were wondering, oh, what's going on? So at random, if you connect nodes at random, you wouldn't have large nodes like Lady Gaga. So what's going on? Why Lady Gaga on Twitter is so popular comparing to, say, the average popularity between people? So then they, for example, introduced the preferential attachment model, which is a very simple model for these complex networks. Mm-hmm. And again, nobody, I guess, claims that that's a model that, that produces web graph and, you know, I can just compare these two guys and they look the same. No, no one says that. But what we learn at the end of this process is that in these networks, we have the so-called rich get richer principle. So that's why you have power law degree distribution in these networks. Because if you gain a lot of neighbors, then the probability that someone new connects to you should be proportional to the power that you already accumulated, to the number of neighbors you already accumulated. So that's why it's like a not fair competition. If you're a little bit ahead of the competition, then you gain more, you know, bigger chunk of the cake comparing to something else. So that's what we see, and that's what we can try to model. So many models have this rich get richer principle incorporated. Yeah, I forgot to mention, but stop me anytime you have question. I'll be more than happy to answer. So the question is, you know, what if you want to have a good model, what we should have in our model to be happy with it? Well, I guess of course we should reproduce all those observed properties, right? It would be kind of strange to claim, oh, my model is good, but it produces something that's completely different than what the real network looks like. So we would like to have, you know, the degree distribution similar to what we want to model. We want to have, say, again, a small average distance. We want to have some naturally occurring clusters. So maybe there's some parts of the graph which are kind of surprisingly denser comparing to the global density, and we would like to have maybe a weak, you know, bad expansion property and so on. So all those things we want to mimic, but on the other hand, we want to have something simple, something natural for agents. So again, I don't like models where you have million parameters and you have to, you know, tune all of them to get what you want, because of course that might be very useful for kind of prediction model. If you want to understand, you know, what's going on tomorrow on the stock market, of course I wouldn't mind having a perfect model which does it with 100 parameters that I have to tune, right? I can spend the whole night trying to, you know, trying to predict what's going to happen tomorrow. If I'm succeeding, then I'm happy. But for me, I just want to learn something. So I want to have something natural that, you know, that can reveal what's going on later on. And many existing models have one problem, namely, we always assume that when there's someone joins the network, then someone knows exactly everything about that network. So like preferential attachment model has that feature, so the new node joining the network connects to one node with probability proportional to its degree. So technically we're assuming that when you join the network, you know every single degree distribution. That's kind of silly, right? You cannot assume that when you're creating a website, you just know the whole internet, and then you just decide, oh, I'm going to put a hyperlink to that website because I like it. So that's not what's going on. We should have some model that only has very limited local information about the network. So those are like a few things that I think a good model should have. And what I would like to see as an outcome of this model, I would like to see communities kind of naturally emerging from the model. So because I want to understand, you know, why these communities occur and how we can detect them and so on. So I don't want to have like this embedded into the model. I want to have them kind of naturally showing up. And that's what's needed, because as you can guess, you know, in the real networks we have these communities. So if we look at the web graph, you have, you know, web pages which contain related topics. They have like dense in terms of hyperlinks between them, and sparse globally. And the same applies to many other networks, like co-authors. If they share the same research interest, then of course this part of the graph is quite dense. But rarely they collaborate with people outside of the field. So that's what should be happening in the network. Okay, so what would be the good idea for our models? Well, I guess it would be nice to kind of assume that there's some kind of underlying metric happening in this thing. So let me put it that way. So, for example, let's think that I'm joining Facebook today. How do I connect to the existing people there? I guess it's not just by pure randomness that I just connect to a few people in the first day and maybe next day to another few people. It's not just by pure randomness. It's more like I'm connecting to them because they are similar to me. And what does it mean? Well, it could mean a lot of different things. Maybe they have similar interests, or maybe they live close by, right? Maybe they have completely different interests, but I see them every day when I'm buying bread. Or maybe, you know, have similar, hairstyle. They hold the same hairstyle. So, you know, there are many, many aspects why these guys are close to each other. But in some sense, there is some underlying space that we live in, and the reason we connect, you know, to each other is that we are sometimes, you know, very often close to each other in that space. So it would be nice. I think that's what the conclusion is. It would be nice to have a model which incorporates that observation, that it would be good to have vertices or nodes embedded in some space, right? And that's not only applying to social networks, like I mentioned, but let's say a web graph. If you create a web graph, if you create a new website, you have some content, right? You have a content, you put some text on it, and in some sense, that tells you what is this website about. And now if it's about, say, mathematics, with higher probability you create links to other websites on mathematics. So again, it makes a lot of sense to try to model these guys putting nodes on some space, and then use some kind of mechanism that uses this distribution of nodes. So I guess that's what I said. So it would be very good to place nodes in this space. So some people call it a feature space. It could be high dimensional, that's fine. There might be many aspects in which we can be close to each other on Facebook. And this space tells us you know, how close I am to some other people. And the generation of edges should be a function of that. But maybe more importantly, at least for the company's point of view, this gives us the base for this reverse engineering, because usually we see a network, but usually we do not see this underlying structure. And usually we care about underlying structure more than the network, right? So let me just try to come up with some example. Let's say, you know, I'm working for Facebook, and I know that John Smith likes Harry Potter movie. So I want to advertise that guy, you know, advertise this movie to some other users that like that. So the question is, who is similar to John Smith on Facebook? Of course, I know all the neighbors of John Smith, right? I work for Facebook, so I know all the neighbors and neighbors of neighbors, and I know everything about the graph, but who cares? I don't care who is the neighbor of John Smith, because not all the neighbors of John Smith like Harry Potter. So I would like to understand who is similar to John Smith, but all I have available is this network. But now, if you have a good model that says, well, this is the model that captures what's going on, then I can try to predict, you know, who is similar to who in this model. And that gives me an algorithm how to find similar people to John Smith using the real network. I don't know if that makes sense. So, yeah? Yeah. Right. So you know. So I'm not saying it's easy, right? But yeah.
The space should be
equipped with some additional structure. Uh-huh. No. Yeah, I can repeat the question. So I guess the question is the problem.
Надо все время держать. Sorry. Okay. So I thought about such sort of models and. I think that it is this additional structure maybe is needed to.
Right. So I'm not saying yes. Yeah. So like I said, I'm not saying it's easy, and definitely it's a different for different network. As you say, you know, it might be a network where similar people actually maybe don't like the same thing. Right. It could be the same, and it could be like negative correlation and things like that. Yeah, I guess so. Right. Well, but what I'm saying, yeah, right. Yeah, but then what we are saying in some sense is that if I understand that, so of course, first of all, when I see a network and I want to have a good model, I have to do first data mining and then, you know, keep, start understanding, you know, how this real network works. And then, as you say, maybe I'll discover that there's some negative correlation. People close to each other to this space have a smaller probability of being connected, for example. That's fine. So we can just incorporate that into the model and then still try to use this reverse engineering to get a prediction who is similar to who. So yeah, there are many aspects and many like individual approaches for specific networks. So yeah, definitely you have to have your brain open and try to understand what you are doing, what you are trying to model. So yeah, finally I'm about to say something about the model that I want to tell you about. So there are many models, and I was involved in many projects with different models involved. But this one is kind of cute, I like it. Maybe the reason is that that's the one I introduced, so that's why I probably like it. But it has some features that are interesting in the sense that it's a spatial model. So it will fit nicely to the story I'm trying to tell you about. But of course, as you say, there might be a completely different situation where this model doesn't make any sense. You should come up with a different model, and then, you know, good for us, we can prove more theorems about this model. So again, I'm just trying to summarize what's known, maybe a little bit more more concrete way. So we sprinkle our nodes, and there also will be points in some Euclidean space. So I have to have a way to measure how close to each other these nodes are. So I'll pick a unit hypercube, m dimensional hypercube, and then. You can pick any norm you want. So if you're not a mathematician, don't be scared. Just, you know, like the way to measure the distance between those two points. And maybe what's like technical problem, I think about this as a torus. So instead of, say, for example, a piece of paper, two-dimensional, you know, object, I just make it glue together and have a donut. So this is just the reason to.
In any feature, extremes are
close. Yeah. Yeah, in all the feature. Yes. Yeah. So in every single feature, because I don't want to have bunger effects, and this is only for my theorems to be easy, so that you know I don't have to think, oh, what's going on if I land very very close to the bungery. So that's just a little technical problem. But of course, you don't have to assume it. The proofs will be exactly the same, but with extra more work. So I'm just giving myself an easy job by gluing these things. But yeah, you can you don't have to use the torus metric. Yeah, like in North America, we say donuts. I don't know, maybe in Eastern Europe, probably it's called something else, like I don't know, torus metric, two dimensional. With torus metric, it's donut for us. Right, but that's just a technicality. So don't worry, it doesn't have to be like that. It's just easier. And then, did I say it? I didn't say it, but it's here. So my notes are sprinkled randomly and uniformly. So each time a new user joins the network, it will be placed in that space with uniform probability. And then each node will have the so-called sphere of influence. So what's the sphere of influence? Well, the volume of that sphere of influence will be proportional to the degree. So the more neighbors I have, then the more bigger sphere of influence I have. And we have these two parameters. So you multiply your degree by A1, which is a parameter of the model. I add it to A2 and divide it by time. So everything will be scaled by time. The time is a discrete time. So at time one, it will be one node. At time t, will be t nodes in my network. And maybe what's maybe worth pointing out is that for now, I'm thinking about directed graph. So there will be always someone generating a link to someone else. And this means it's in degree. So the number of people that pointed out to me. So I think it is always, it will, generally it will shrink, but of course, if you gain more neighbors, then locally, maybe you grow. But I think, yeah, in general, your spheres of influence will be shrinking. And I think always it's good to think about some application already, although it might be kind of silly. So maybe let's think about trying to model the citation graph. So my notes will be papers, and each note will be citing some papers. Right, so I think it makes sense. Well, it doesn't make sense that they're randomly and uniformly distributed because you know more people work in, say, computer science than I don't know, some obscure, which I'm not going to name because maybe someone is in the audience. But so yeah, right. but not uniformly. That's what I'm saying. So we fixed that. So we can make the model non-uniform distribution, but for now, let's say it's randomly distributed. So papers appear in random places, and then, of course, the more people cite you, the more papers cite your paper, then your paper is more famous. It has a larger sphere of influence. So it makes sense to have this like that. Okay, and then what's going on? If the new node joins the network, if someone writes a paper, say, V is the new paper. V can cite someone, but who can cite V? Well, I guess only those papers that are close. So only these papers that have a sphere of influence that include V. And again, I think it makes sense, right? Because let's say you have a very little paper that is very similar to what you are doing, right? You are writing a paper and you are hesitating who I should cite. So you're writing a paper and maybe there is a paper very closely related to what you are doing, but it's not so famous paper. Maybe it has zero citations or maybe three. But you still want to cite it because you are very close to that guy. So even though the sphere of influence of you is very tiny, you still want to cite it. On the other hand, maybe there's some other node far away from you, but it's so influential that the sphere of influence is so big. It's like a, you know, some famous paper that has million citations or maybe 1,000 citations. So So of course, maybe it's not really related to what you are doing, but it's maybe some model that vaguely is similar to you, but you know, it's a famous model, so you cite it. So I think it makes sense from that perspective too. So your new note, your new paper has to fall into a sphere of influence of the existing paper, and of course more influential papers will be cited more because their spheres are huge. But on the other hand, you don't really care what's going on. You know, if there's some obscure paper somewhere else that no one's citing, then I guess you don't care about that at all. It's not in your field, so you're not aware of that paper, I guess. But still, even if you fall into the sphere of influence, you still make a decision. So you still think about, do I want to cite that paper or not? So what we're doing, we are citing a paper with probability P. So that's another parameter of the model. So I have three parameters. I complain that I like many parameters. Already have three, but that's it. So A1, A2, that's something that will be will affect my sphere of influence, and then probability P, that's the probability I'm connecting to a node such that I fell into it. Exactly. Yeah, it can be a large number. So I think that's actually good because you know, provincial adaptation model has a fixed number of neighbors, and people complain about it because they say, well, if you are generating a new website, why do you assume that you generate m hyperlinks each time? No, it should be kind of like more natural way. If you're writing a paper in a hot area, you might want to cite many papers. If you start a new area, maybe you land on the desert, right? You write a paper on this topic, which no one is around you, then you cite no one. Or maybe you cite only one or two people that are very influential that fall into you. So this the number of links I'm creating, it's a random variable and has some distribution, but it's not a deterministic number. Yeah, so I guess we covered all of that, or some of that, let's see. So the good thing is that we have only local information. So again, I don't really know, and I don't really need to know what's going on in this different part of the world, which of course makes a lot of sense, because again, if you're joining the Facebook, you probably don't want to you don't know who is on that Facebook network on the other side. So you only know maybe some local information about people. So that's good. And then, as you pointed out, the number of links that I'm going to establish when I join the network is not fixed a priori. It's a random variable, and it can be very small or can be relatively large. But these influential guys are also good because there are just a few of them in the network, but they help us to make those sporadic long links. So I think that also makes sense because if you don't have these, if you just have purely random geometric graph, then diameter will be huge. So that's not what we want. We want to have really those kind of sporadic short links that can bring us. And if you think about this, that's what's happening in the citation graph, because you know, like you can travel from one field to the other, just hopping between those influential papers. So that all makes sense. That's what people, I guess, like about that model. That's just a picture. I don't know if you care about pictures, but you know, you see those highly degree nodes somewhere there. They're probably old. And then you have many vertices with just a few neighbors or maybe nothing. They just landed in an empty spot. So first result I want to tell you is the degree distribution. So as I mentioned, then many networks have the so-called power law degree distribution, and so it would be nice to have it as well. So we show that this model has a parallel degree distribution with parameter 1 plus 1 over p. So again, I don't think I said it anywhere. What is the power law? It means that the number of nodes with degree k scales like k to minus x. So it's going down. So of course, if I want to look at, I want to count nodes of degree k, where k is growing, then of course I have less and less vertices, but it doesn't grow, doesn't decrease exponentially. It decreases like a polynomial, so it doesn't go too fast. So I still have vertices of large degree, and this time the power law exponent is this. So I'm not sure.
What is n?
N is the number of that's t for some reason. So t is supposed to be n. So at t is the number of vertices in my network. So if you look at n at t, yeah, that's what I'm going to explain now, I guess. Thank you for the question. So if you look at n I t, that's going to be the number of nodes of degree I at time t. So, and again, the degree for me is the in degree. So how many, so this tells me how many nodes I have that are lonely in the sense that no one connected to them. So I'll have positive fraction of nodes like that, and what is the fraction is 1 over 1 plus p. So that's what it means. But then if you want to know how many nodes of degree k I have at time t, that is this formula. And if you look at this closer, it for large k, it scales like k to minus x. So it's a power law degree distribution. So there are other things that you should ask about, I guess. What's this AAS? So all my results are asymptotic in nature. So so I'm assuming that t or n, the number of vertices, is going to grow to infinity. That makes sense, I guess, right? So it's much easier to work with asymptotics in this field. So, but also it makes sense from kind of applied point of view, right? We're in a big data era, after all. So all our networks are big. They're not tending to infinity, but at least, you know, they're large. So this asymptotic behavior should be what's happening in the real networks that are finite, of course. And asymptotic almost surely means what? Well, of course, still, for example, what could happen in this network is that all the nodes will land on the same place, which is ridiculous, right? That happens with probability zero. Or maybe they are close to each other, and that happens with probability 1 over e to minus n, 1 over e to the n. So, you know, strange things could happen, but I don't care about those strange things that could happen. I care about things that happen with high probability, which means with probability tending to 1 as n goes to infinity. So that's what it means, AAS. It means it's the probability that, you know, all I say here holds with probability tending to 1 as n goes to infinity.
Is it true that it doesn't depend on an initial state? So if we start not from a single point, but from a fixed state of connections, and then we start to add point after point?
Yeah, I think that would depend. That must change something, although it's not clear, because these random variables are in some sense kind of self-correcting, in the sense that if you have too many vertices, for example, if you have too many vertices that are isolated, then the probability of joining, of getting, destroying one isolated vertex will be higher. So I would have to think about it, but usually the initial stages, you know, the initial steps affect something. But if you start with a small graph, let's say on root of n vertices, and then wait up to n, then I think still we will get the same same result. So of course, if you give me something on say half n vertices, you know, surprisingly sparse graph or surprisingly dense graph, then I'm not going to fix that. But if you start with something small, then that shouldn't affect my final result. Because again, you will see it in a second, but these random variables are very nice in the sense that they have some self-correcting behavior. Because, you know, you should just think for a second. Let's say that at some point you have too many isolated vertices. You expect to be, you know, the expected fraction to be small, but you surprisingly have many more. So what does it mean? Well, it means that the new node that joins the network will be surrounded by many isolated vertices, which means with high probability, I'm going to connect to one of those, and then the number of isolated vertices goes down, which means this random variable should be self-correcting. And if it's too small, then of course the chances that I'm hitting someone is not that good. But this is very subtle, so you know I don't want to claim it holds in any scenario, but I can imagine that if you start with, say, 20 vertices and you put them somewhere in the corner, I don't think that's going to affect the degree distribution.
Are you using some continuous limits, maybe? You find invariant measure on the Tor?
No, nothing like that. So it's still discrete.
System, certainly dynamic system in the space of measures, mm-hmm. And this seems like a... approximation for invariant measure.
Maybe, sounds like it, but yeah, I'm not a continuous mathematician, although, you know, one thing that you will see in a second is the differential equation method. So what we are using here is kind of like maybe interesting stuff, because we go from discrete mathematics to continuous, do some work over there, and then come back, translate results to discrete mathematics. So it's not that sophisticated as you say, but it's kind of like maybe not so natural choice. Not too many people move from discrete to continuous. And if they move there, they never come back. Right, so... So that's maybe interesting. So yeah, just give you a taste. It will be very simple. So my talk is kind of like North American talk. I'm originally from Poland, so I got used to heavy loaded math talks, but I switched to North America and I start liking easy talks that I can follow from the beginning to the end. So it's a very easy talk, so hopefully everyone understands everything. That's my goal. So yeah, so just a little taste, that will be probably the only mathematics, and it's very simple mathematics in this talk. So how do we apply this differential equation method? So what's going on? How can we, for example, try to show that the number of isolated vertices, the number of vertices that nobody connected to is this fraction of the total number of nodes? So I'm going to use a so-called martingales. So what is this? It's a sequence of random variables. I want to have the property that if you ask me what is the expected value at the next round, and you tell me what the value is in the current round, I want to have the expectation to be exactly the current value. Right? So that's the definition of the martingale. And for example, you know, maybe you toss a coin, and then you look at the difference between number of heads and number of tails, or maybe even easier, think about random walk. Each time with probability half, I'm going up. I'm just adding one to the current number I see, and with probability half, I'm going down. So it's a simple random walk on integers, and that's a martingale. Because if I tell you my value is 17, I go to 18 with probability half, I go to 16 with probability half, so the expectation is still 17. So that's a martingale. And what we know is the so-called Hevding-Azum inequality, which tells us, look, if you have a martingale, and moreover, it's never the case that from step 1 to step 2, or from step k minus 1 to k, it's never the case that you go up or go down by a lot, then with high probability, with you know exponentially, you know, with probability is tending to zero exponentially fast, you are not going to drift away from the initial value. So that's why, in some sense, you can prove that if you toss a coin n times, then with high probability, you're not going to be you know, far away from you know, the difference between the number of heads and number of tails is not going to be much bigger than, say, some constant root of n. So, of course, you can prove it using, say, Chernoff bound. You can use it in many different ways, but you can use martingales for that as well. So that's kind of natural thing. So again, if you have a martingale, you expect to stay on the same level. Then if the differences are not so drastic, then with high probability, you're not going to drift away too far from the initial value. So now let's come back to my random variable. So again, what do we look at? We look at the number of vertices at time t that are isolated, that have n degree zero. So those are the vertices that nobody connected to. So let's say I'm at time t, and I know the number of them. So I know that these verses are there. Maybe I have 17 million of those. I know it. So now the question is, what do I expect to see? You know, what is the expected difference? How many more isolated verses I can get? Well, of course, one I always get for free because a new guy joins the network and it's going to be isolated. So so one joins the network and it will be isolated. But then, of course, this new guy can generate some links, so I'm perhaps losing some isolated verses. So how many of them I lose in expectation? Well, I lose, first of all, this is going to be, okay, let me see. PA over T, that's the area of influence of an isolated node. So I'm losing that node with probably PA2 over T. And now, since I have n0t of them by linear of expectation, that's the expected number of nodes I'm going to lose. So that was, they're very simple, so I know what is expected difference is. And unfortunately, it's not a martingale. It's not zero, right? I expect to gain more isolated verses each round. So what do? Well, for now, we are physicists, right? So for now, I'm just applying heuristic algorithm. And if everything I say doesn't make any sense, right? In some sense, it's not rigorous. But I want to get an intuition what's going on. And once I get the intuition what's going on, I can make things more rigorous. So, so what do we do? I say, first of all, let me pretend that my random variable, you know, changes as we expect, right? You shouldn't believe it, but you know, why not? Let's pretend that they are very good random variables, right? Not the naughty ones. They go where I want them to go. So that's one thing. And then I say, oh, let's scale both the time and the random variable itself by n. Okay, so then I get, you know, difference equation. And then I say, oh, n tends to infinity. So in some sense, I can try to model these things by differential equation. So I get the differential equation. So It's just heuristic, so no proof yet. But what we are kind of what we gain as intuition is that my random variables should behave like this solution to this differential equation. So I'm just doing this for one variable. For more variables, we have of course system of differential equations, so things become more complicated. But so far, all I have is just simple function, and of course even I can solve it. So that's the general solution to this different equation. And after that, we try to be mathematicians again. So we are coming back to mathematics, and we say, oh, if that's what's happening, instead of looking at my random variable x, I should be really looking at this new function, which is a function of two variables. And the reason for that is that if I evaluate function h at time t, which is the time, and I stick in as a second y, I stick in a second argument the random variable counting how many isolated nodes I have, then this new random variable should be close to zero. So all I did this heuristic for is to get an intuition how my random variable should behave. And once I get that intuition, so I'm still not certain if that's the case, but if everything goes well, so fingers crossed, then my random variable should behave like this. So I just stick it into this function, and I'm not getting a martingale, but what you can try to show, so that's again some Taylor expansion, so nothing fancy, so it's really elementary proof in some sense. So you stick it in, and then you try to evaluate what is the expected difference in this new random variable. And it turns out that the expected difference is really small, and the maximum difference is not too big, so you stick it into the Heveningen-Zeeman inequality, and you're getting that your function h is not drifting away too far from the expectation. And then what does it mean? Well, you just go back to your original random variable. So what do you know? You know that your original random variable is not drifting too far away from this expectation, from this deterministic function. I don't know, does it make any sense, or it was too fast? So yeah, this is just for one variable, but that's the general trick. So again, it has successfully been applied to many fields. So this differential equation method is the method developed by Nick Wormald from University of Waterloo. I was his postdoc, so I guess that was the good time when I had a chance to learn that. It's a very useful trick, in some sense very simple in spirit, but very, very powerful. So again, any discrete process you have, the strategy is that you try to model, you try to first apply some heuristic algorithm, heuristic argument, so you pretend that everything works as you expect. You scale things down, you get a system of differential equations, you solve it, and then using it, that the system of differential equations, you try to modify your random variables that you, so that you see something close to martingale. And then having a Zuman equality gives you the concentration for this new random variable, which implies the concentration for the original random variable. So that not only gives me what's going on at time n, but it gives me the whole trajectory of the process. So I know precisely what's going on during the process, how many isoreversions I had at the half n step, and so on. Okay, so so let's see what else we have. So for example, degree distribution, we already mentioned, it could be zero. We could land in the desert when there's nothing you know, published yet, so we cite nobody. But of course, if you land a very densely populated area, you might have lots of initial neighbors. So the out degree is not bounded by a constant, but in fact, it could be as large as log t over log log t at time t. So again, if you think about it, it's not that surprising, because if you just do this trick with bins and balls, right? So if I chop up my space into little bins so that you expect there only one ball, then of course you will have, just by pure randomness, you will have a bin with many balls, namely log t over log log t. And if that point happens to you know, join that crowd, just by pure randomness, you will have lots of neighbors. But on the other hand, it's not far away to be true, so I put log squared because that was easy to get. But in fact, yes, the same, yeah. Yeah, this is a Poisson distribution, right? Like a Poisson process. Okay, that sounds like a good idea to practice. You see, who is the lucky one? Or maybe unlucky, I don't know. You already know the answer to that question? But unfortunately, right, the heaviest drinker is only log t, so so it's not much more than log t over log log t. So that's guaranteed, but it's never more than log t. Okay, what else? So in these networks, again, people know that there are some sparse cuts. So so if you just say chop off your space and put on the left side, you know, all the people from, you know, this hemisphere, and then on the other side you put the opposite side, then the number of links on Facebook will be very small comparing to the global density. So we have a very sparse cuts in these networks. So again, that's kind of maybe very natural in some sense, right? But on the other hand, it's not natural in a binomial random graphs, because in binomial random graphs you would have a lot of edges across, right? So if you just put links at random, you will have, you know, 1/4 of all the edges will be between left and right, right? Because, you know, like, let's say if you are on the left side, what is the probability you connect to the other side? It's half. So in a binomial random graphs, you would have very dense cuts, but in these networks, surprisingly, there are very sparse cuts. And we proved that in a SPA model, you have sparse cuts, and that was at some point a few years ago. But recently, we started looking at modularity. So this is some new graph parameter, at least new to me. So people started looking at modularity as a way to cluster the graph. So if you want to find a collection of sets, so that you know these sets represent some kind of like a clusters in your graph. So what do we want to have? Well, I guess we want to have first of all, you want to capture as many edges as possible in those sets. So if I partition the graph into, say, 7 clusters, I want to have a lot of edges within clusters, but with a few edges across. Right? If you want to cluster your citation graph, you want to put all your papers in mathematics on the left side, all the papers in computer science here, and biology there, and so on. You want to cluster this, so we expect that there will be a lot of edges within the cluster, but very few between. So we want to find a partition so that the total number of edges captured is very close to 1 as a fraction. So we want this term to be close to 1. But it's a little risky because, you know, if you want to capture as many edges possible, you can just take a cluster which has everyone else, everyone inside. So this is a natural trivial partition that can achieve this ratio to be 1. So what people said, and mostly, I guess, at the beginning, physicists, they said, well, we want to have the following. We want to have not only capture as many edges as possible, but we do not want to have too few or too uneven parts. So that's why they put this, on top of this edge contribution, they put the so-called degree tax. So they want to subtract some other quantity which should be high if you have large sets or uneven. So that's this tax. And you want to maximize that with respect to all the partitions you can think of, and that gives you the big number here, and the partition you have gives you nice clusters. So yeah, it's very, in some sense, it's challenging to think about the graph parameter, because you know you take a you consider all the partitions and try to maximize your quantity among them, but that's kind of like general intuition what we want to do. We want to capture many edges within clusters and have not too many uneven not too small. Not too large clusters. So last week we started looking at that. So we look at random deregular graphs because there were some known upper bounds and lower bounds by Colin McDiarmid from Oxford and his student, I guess. So we improved some of their lower upper bounds, but also we look at the parameterization model and the SPA model, as I like it. So why not, right? And not surprisingly, non-spatial models, they do not have high modularity. So that shows that these models are fine for other purposes, but they're not generating clusters. They're not generating locally dense, globally sparse models. But if you take any other spatial model, for example, spatial profile attachment, these models, they have, you know, naturally clusters, because you know most of your neighbors are close to yourself. So if you chop off your space so that you have, people close to each other in this metric space in a cluster, then you should have few edges across. So we have that result that says that the modularity tends to 1 as the number of nodes goes to infinity. So I'm staying here till Wednesday, so more theorems will come soon. So also we know the diameter. So the directed diameter is a little challenging to define, right? Because how do you define it? I guess you want to have a sequence of oriented edges. So we are searching for the longest, shortest directed path. Right, so if I tell you, if I give you two nodes, I want to have the shortest directed path between them, and then I want to find the pair that gives me the longest, shortest directed path. So that's the diameter, and we know it's logarithmic at most, and at least log t over log t. So I think the upper bound is the correct one, but this was already like 20 pages long proof, so I guess we gave up And for technical reasons, we have this weaker lower bound, but it seems like the upper bound is the correct one. But in any case, it's this the so-called small world property. The diameter is not too long. What else? Yeah, this is more like more applied, so I didn't even try to explain what we did, so don't try to even read it. But the story is very easy. So the question was, like Facebook, you know, ask us, for example, can we predict who is similar to who? So this reverse engineering process. So we said, oh, let's look at the SPA model and try to see if we can do something, because if not, then you know you are in big trouble for the real network, for the real model, it will be even harder. So let's see if for SPA model we can predict the distance between users, like between nodes. But what do I mean by distance? Not the graph theory distance, the distance in this metric space. Just having available the graph. So I give you graph only, but I tell you, look, this graph was generated by this model. But I don't give you coordinates. All I give you is the network. The question for you is then, can you tell me what is the distance between node U and V? So we have this theorem that shows that, of course, if we are maybe in a strange places, we cannot predict, but then if we are in the right region, then we are fine. So that's what the term says. And of course, then people complain as well. They say, oh, all your results are asymptotic in nature. What if I give you a network with 100,000 nodes? Is it still, you know, is still this theorem working or not? Maybe asymptotic means that, you know, you have some, the number of nodes is some tower function. You need to have, more users than molecules in the world. So they say, no, let's see if this theorem works well for non-asymptotic, for finite size networks. So maybe that picture is better. So that shows that how we predict the distance versus the real distance that was revealed after the experiment. So of course, if you are perfect, it will be a straight line. We are not perfect, but I hope you are happy or with the outcome. So sometimes we are not predicting the distance well. So this is maybe the actual distance versus the estimated distance. So we're not so good in non-asymptotic region. In the asymptotic behavior, if n tends to infinity, that would be a straight line. But in a smaller network, it's not great. But it's still pretty good job. And then the next complaint we heard is that, well, okay, but our networks are not uniformly distributed. But that's not a problem. Here, we may pretend that, you know, locally they're uniformly distributed. So you just kind of approximate your network. And we did that work as well. But the theorems are even uglier, so I don't even try to present them. But the long story short, there is a way to try to predict the distance if all you have available to yourself is the network. And then, of course, we don't know what they're doing with that, but we are told that it makes a lot of sense and it behaves well, because at least, you know, they have a function, they have a tool to try to measure the distance. And then, of course, this model is not really a Facebook, so they have to go back to their desks and try to see if this prediction works well for them. So so that's a completely different question, I guess. But we were told that these tools are working fine. Okay, so just a possible future directions. I don't know, I'm supposed to talk 1 hour, I guess, maybe a little bit more. No worries, so I can talk till tomorrow. But no, I think let's try to finish. So there's two concrete problems, I guess, in this area. So I'm working on this model on and off. I'm doing many other things, coloring.
Before 10, that this is a match in our group.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So I'm not working on this model too often, but there are some things that still are open. So for example, at some point we had a quick look at the giant component. So I want to understand how many vertices are, you know, in a component that is the largest in the network. So if you come back to, you know, if you remember the picture, If you forget about directions of links, you will see a huge component where nodes can communicate with other nodes. But there will be a few other islands that there's no way you can go from one to the other. So I want to understand what is the size of the largest component in that network. And we did some experiments to get the intuition, but the standard tricks like Galton-Watson processes, right? Like people usually use branching processes to understand what's going on in these networks. So all those tricks unfortunately do not work. So they give us only some upper lower bounds, but they don't match. So you know, we put a conjecture like that in the paper, but I guess not a strong feeling. So you know, we didn't have a strong evidence for that. Just conjecture something with the hope maybe that conjecture is wrong, because I think more people like disproving conjectures than proving them. So if you say something and it can be disproved, you know, you have a higher chance to be cited, right? So yeah, we just put some number. And then the other conjecture is that if you look at the clustering coefficient, then the vertex of k should be, you know, should have a clustering, local clustering coefficient of order 1 over k. So I've had a little demo is doing some results around that topic for the presentation model. But you know, the same thing should happen here, and that should be also easy to, or relatively easy to prove. So those are concrete questions. Maybe more like a common question is that, of course, maybe not mathematicians, but computer scientists, they try to really tune these things, you know, to model these networks. So there are, you know, outgoing research going on in this area, which I'm not part of, but I know that people are trying to tune, and that applies to every single model. And then, of course, you know, people look at some other properties of graphs, not only diameter, not only giant component, but also, you know, maybe small subgraph counts. I want to match the number of triangles here and there. So there's many interesting stuff going on, and many people do many different things. But I think what I want to point out is something that I think it's maybe the next step. So if you just think about bigger picture, initially, people were looking at models without geometry, right? Because that was kind of the most natural step. We had this preferential model, copying model, and many other models. Random irregular graphs, random binomial random graphs, and so on. So no geometry at all. Now we have many models with geometry, which is good, because that's what really is happening. So we have not only SPA model, but there are models with hyperbolic planes, which are kind of interesting, and the pictures are nice. So we have many interesting models that are spatial, but I think the next step would be to look at models where actually nodes move. And that would be interesting from math point of view, but it's even more interesting from applied point of view. So this is a project that I used to have with BlackBerry. So they have the following situation. So they have users, they're using their cell phones, and what they know about users, I guess they know a lot of things, but what they, for example, know is what they're doing, so what is their taste. So if you're watching this on your cell phone, doing this on your cell phone, then the company knows your taste. They know you like hobby, you like hockey, I guess they know that you like math, then they know that you don't like this, and so on. So they have a vector assigned to every single user, and then each category tells them how strongly you like this thing. So they have a m-dimensional vector, usually each coordinate is between 0 and 1. So we have that, and now they test it, or we test it, we confirm that it's definitely the case when you establish a new connection, because they also have the so-called, I have this, some network, I think, like Messenger. So they know who talked to who. So you establish connections to users that have similar tastes. That doesn't make you know, big surprise. So if you're connecting to people, usually those people are similar to you. So yeah, so you have not only taste for each user, so you know, you have these spatial location of each user, but then okay, yeah. Right. So here you have that, and then these guys talk to each other. So very often they connect to people that are similar. That's a surprising thing, and they disconnect from people that are dissimilar. That's also not that surprising, and that's really what was verified for these networks. But then now, what's going on else? Well, not only your taste influences who you connect to, but also the network around you shapes your taste. So maybe by pure randomness, I'm connecting to someone with a different taste, and by interacting with that person, my taste is changing. So I'm shifting and changing my taste. And of course, what BlackBerry wants to do, and I'm assuming Google, of course, we talk to them as well, and they're interested as well, and Yandex, I'm guessing it's the same situation. You would like to not only understand what your users like, but also they want to understand where do you go to. So I can imagine two users. One is interested in mathematics, but is actually shifting from, I don't know, say applied mathematics to pure mathematics, and then I can imagine second user that is shifting the opposite direction. If you want to advertise the product to pure mathematician, you probably want to advertise this to a person who was going to like it tomorrow, not yesterday, right? So you really would like to understand where users are going to, not only where they are currently, but you want to understand them. So that gives us an application of models where shifting points.
So strategic check, when you form a link, when you decide to form a link or not.
Yeah, I'm not describing even the model. So, you know, I'm just leaving to you to come up with a good model. So all I'm saying is that it is important. Of course, it's very fun from my point of view, right? Like what a cool idea, right? You have shifting points and then things like that. But what I want to say is that it's not only interesting from technical point of view, but it's very interesting from applied point of view. Because again, you really want to understand what's happening, like how people are changing their taste, and that's in social science called social learning. So how people change their tastes as a function of the network surrounding them. So of course, you know, I can imagine that you just look at all your neighbors and maybe slowly go towards the center of that taste, right? So I can imagine network, you know, model like that. And in fact, one of our papers that was published in some, you know, prestigious journal in social science was exactly that, because social scientists think about two things, which for me immediately contradict each other. But first thing was, that people learn and move towards their neighborhoods, and second thing, they have these clusters. But of course, if you keep moving towards your neighborhoods and you don't live on Taurus, you live on the, you know, in the boundary world, then you're going to collapse to a single point, right? Sooner or later. But that's not what they think, right? So again, if you just keep moving towards your neighbors, then of course, if you're an outlier, there's no one behind me, I'm going to move this direction, right? So you can prove it that if you have a network with boundaries, then sooner or later you're going to collapse to one point, right? Or the sum over the distances is going to shrink each time. So you know, like that's what you can prove, and then it contradicts the fact that the social scientists believe that you have a clustered communities and you know, people are not collapsing to one point. You still have people on the left side, people on the right side. So that was interesting to them, I guess. So they said, well, that means that the world is more complicated. And now they are starting to explain why. Maybe we have people that do not change their beliefs no matter what. Maybe that's the reason that we're not collapsing to one point. Or maybe, you know, you have some kind of opposite thing, right? Maybe not only I move towards my neighbors, but I move away from my known neighbors. So, you know, they already started thinking what would be, you know, what are the mechanisms that need to be discovered that are happening in this network. So you know that's interesting stuff. It's just the beginning. So I don't have a real model to tell you, but I think it would be very cool to have models with nodes that are shifting. That's all I'm saying. Yeah, there are many things, even in the SPA model, you can maybe try to generalize the model. Maybe you want to have maybe you want to have an undirected graph, not the directed one. Directed makes a lot of sense for citation network, but for other things, undirected is more natural. So maybe someone wants to generalize that. And then also, we try to only predict the distance between nodes. But what about trying to go one step further and try to uncover the whole structure of the graph? I want to know who is where, and more information about positions between these nodes, not only the distance but where they are in this network. So I think that's it. I have a few advertisements. I don't know, maybe you might be interested in. So that will take me a few seconds. So stay with me. So I'm always try to organize some conferences, workshops. So for example, that's the next one that's coming up. So in Canada, in Banff, in a beautiful located place. Sorry? Too far? Yeah, sorry about that. I sometimes organize something closer, but this time, unfortunately, they're all in North America. So November 6 to 11, that's one workshop in Banff. Then December 14-15, this is the WebGraph conference. So I think at least Ludmila is coming, I hope, or maybe some others, or submitting papers at least. So that's a nice city in Canada. And then even more in the summer next year, there will be a one-month program on complex networks and random graphs in Toronto. So that's a bigger program. So we'll start with the summer school. So you might want to send your students. Then there will be a big combinatorics conference. And then the WOW will be attached to that. And after that will be a workshop for more specialized audience. So so those are the first things coming up soon. And I guess the next WOW might be in Moscow. So we're looking forward to it. That will be also interesting because Yandex is more and more involved in those workshops. So the last advertisement is that I'm not sure how many students are in the audience, but I think I didn't have a chance to tell you a lot about tools. You just barely touched this differential equation method, but I think it's a cool area to work in. So many complaints about discrete mathematics is that people say, well, it's not too serious because all you do is the induction and nothing going on. But the truth is that it's actually not the case. So we are still using many cool tricks. And if you're a student hesitating what to do, then of course, I don't want to tell you continuous mathematics is bad, but I want to just tell you that the discrete mathematics has also nice tricks, nice tools. So I didn't mention any of those, but of course we use the probabilistic methods like first, second moment, Lovaas lemma, and especially algorithmic Lovaas lemma. Now it's a very hot, and people use it to solve many interesting conjectures. And I mentioned about branching processes, that's kind of standard tool. And so you need to know a lot of the generating functions. And then we have convergence of moments method, which is very useful. Pairing model, we're using this recently. Of course, Semeretti-Regalati lemma, I guess that's serious tool. Abel Prize went to Semeretti for this tool. It's not only in the graph theory, but of course it applies to almost everything. So the idea is that if you look from the distance into a big structure, you see some random parts, you see some deterministic parts. So this is really, really cool and powerful. And they have spectral graph theory. So we can think about your graph instead of vertices and edges, you can think about this as a matrix. So they're very rich and deep mathematics there. Of course, pseudo-randomness and many other inequalities and tricks that people can use. So and if you like algebraic, then you have some algebraic tools as well that we are using. So many interesting stuff. And if you like analysis, you have graph limits. So everyone can find something for herself or himself. So that's really, really cool, I think. So yeah, there are more obscure things, but I'm always surprised that, you know, sometimes I try to analyze complex network and then you see some, I don't know, even what is this, incomplete gamma function that pops up as an outcome. So so you would never guess that things like that happen in discrete mathematics, but they are, so you're never bored. So I think I'll stop here and hopefully that convinces you to consider discrete mathematics if you're a student.
Okay, great, thank you very much. Now it's probably time to have a few more questions or comments, some discussion.
So I have a question. Do you know if anyone analyzed clusters in this model you talk about today, or in some maybe similar models?
In the similar models, yes, I think there is this person from Litva, right? Or Botva. I can send you a link to that person. I think he analyzed it, but not for spatial models. He was doing more on intersection graphs, right? Probably know who I talked to.
Yes, I remember. I don't remember.
I think that's the only. Don't remember the name, but that's the only person I'm aware of. So. So he did some work on intersection, random intersection graphs, but I think that's the only result, except you know, like yours, that I am aware of. So I don't know.
Because, as far as we can see from the picture you presented, so here we have quite realistic graph. I mean that we have a few clusters of large size, and so probably like the distribution of clusters is. Sizes of clusters is probably really heavy tailed, and maybe do you have some intuition about this distribution? I mean that
intuition for the SPA model.
Yes. Or, okay. Like, do we have exponential sizes of clusters or maybe Pareto distributed? I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, you talk about clusters or you talk about clustering coefficient?
Clusters.
Or clusters.
Yes. I understand that it is hard to analyze mathematically, but mm-hmm. maybe you have some intuition how sizes of clusters are distributed. No,
I have no idea, no. And I guess you want to maximize the modularity for that, right? So,
yes, so one of the ways. Right.
Yeah, so this we show that it's tending to one, but it's I guess hard to find the best partition, and I have no idea what that would be.
Yes, I thought that maybe some of your co-authors, like more practical ones, maybe they looked at this, because I don't know.
Okay. No, that's a good question, but I don't know. Yeah.
Thank you.
So I think that all it says is that, of course, we do have clusters, and it's not that surprising, but really what is the best, you know, what's the departition that does the best job, I have no idea, no. I didn't think about it, but I agree, that's from a point of view, that's what you want to know.
Could you recommend any approach genetic models which could describe some fixed multiple connections, for example, to help to make some distributions for a new vertex when it can connect both vertexes A, B, and C, all three vertexes A, B, and C, but not to only one of them.
Yeah, so I guess, well, we can try to brainstorm and try to come up with some model that will be good, but depending what you want to do, I guess if you want to apply this model in applied world, then I can come up with some models that perhaps make sense, but if you want to analyze it rigorously from math point of view, then I would be very careful, because what you want to do, I understand, is that you want to have a very rich dependent structure, right? You want to have the following property, that when I connect to A, I'm not connecting to B, or vice versa, I'm connecting to A together with someone else. So the reason why binomial random graph, why you know, many of these models are tractable, you know, like it's possible to analyze them, then they have usually a very large degree of independence. Right, so you have to have a lot of independence in your model so that you can say something. If you keep adding, you know, very difficult conditions that are, you know, making edges in the being to very dependent on each other, then many things break down. So you have to be careful, and in your model, if you want to apply this, you know, if you want to analyze them rigorously, you have to be careful not to introduce a lot of dependencies. So, but we can talk about it later, I guess, if you want, yeah, maybe easier. But from applied point of view, of course, if you don't care about theorems, you just want to have a model that works well in practice, then of course, yeah, we have simulations, we have Monte Carlo simulations, other tricks that can be used to understand the model. But then I would be very skeptical. You probably won't be able to prove many things about these things.
Unclear remarks. Then we use a full unique nodes. Then we can, using agnostic sociology, so for deep regularity, we can find some alternative methods. So, keywords alternative sociology, agnostic sociology and unique nodes, we can develop alternative theory. And this theory can tested some general theory, common general theory.
Okay, I'm not sure I really understand the question, but again, we can maybe talk after.
Alternative Robert Burton sociology, and some school with alternative Robert Burton agnostic sociology.
Okay, I'm not sure I know this work, so. It would be difficult for me to comment on that.
This is status, scientific status of sociology, and maybe full negation sociology.
Okay. Yeah, we can talk about it maybe after. I guess I will need to spend more time with you to catch up with the terminology we're using, because I don't really understand, I guess, the question.
It's complicated when we
well, maybe too complicated for me. Maybe not not too complicated for you.
Then we begin full unique nodes, and we then run an alternative theory, full alternative theory, then unique nodes, and agnostic sociology.
Okay. Yeah, sorry, I don't even understand the question, so yeah, maybe later we can talk. I'll be happy to talk, or someone else can expand this, yeah?
Thank you for your talk, and here you present the graph model, and what maybe you know, what is there any criterion or objective that can estimate the quality of this model? General criterion that estimate the quality of the graph model. So we can create many models, and how we use what is better.
Well, yeah. So I don't think I can answer good this question, and the usual answer is that of course all models are wrong, right? Like you have this famous quote by statistician, I think Box, right? All models are wrong, but some of them are useful. So of course, depending on the situation, I think that's how you would quantify the work, right? So if we can come up with the model and then this model predicts, you know, this reverse engineering well, that's a good that's a good model. But of course for other things it will be harder. So like I said at the very beginning, I look at these models not to try to kind of mimic the real network that we try to model, because that's usually hard, and also it's not the goal, right? Because I can formally define you how the model is similar to the neural network, right? So for example, you can think about graph edit distance. So I give you two graphs, and then the distance between these two graphs is a simple metric space. It would be the number of edges I have to delete or add to make these two graphs to be isomorphic. So that's a really well-defined distance. Uh-huh. But for example, I wouldn't be surprised if the SPA model gives you bigger, large distance to some other real network. But that doesn't mean that model is wrong. So I just want to look at the model to gain some intuition what's going on. So not try to be perfect. So that's why it's kind of difficult to say, oh, this model is better. I can make this rigorous. I can make this graph edit distance, and now we have a competition. Your model is better than mine because if I take Facebook, it predicts well. Yeah, so at the end of the day, I want to understand more. I want to understand the processes better. So like for example, if you look at this again, this distance between nodes based on a graph, maybe my theorem is not giving me things perfectly, but at least it should give people that are applied in applied world, they should give them something to think about, some tool to play with. So maybe they have to tune some constants, but at least intuitively they understand that, oh, if I look at the number of common neighbors, or if I look at the number of the degree of the vertex and so on, I can try to predict the distance in this Euclidean space below. So I think that's the main reason. I don't want to quantify which model is better, which model is worse.
I just have a comment here. So speaking about this distance between graphs, so in order to apply this, you have to order the verses correctly, which is like n factorial.
Well, you could, but right. So I'm not. So yeah, I'm not even touching the question how difficult it is to estimate the distance. But from math point of view, from pure point of view, yes, there is a metric space defined for graphs. So you give me two graphs on n vertices, I can compute. What is the distance? What is the edit distance between these two graphs? So I guess that might be like a fair competition. We have Facebook. We have the graph distance. And then this edit distance, and then your model is better than mine because you're closer to the real network.
Check n factorial possible ordering of vertices in order to find kind of the best one. Since we want to find
this projection. Yeah, it's even worse than that because we want to find the sequence of adding or deleting edges. So, that by itself could be and choose two, right? And the order doesn't matter, I guess. So maybe it's a little bit better than what you're saying, but it's still a very, very, very complicated thing to do. But again, I wouldn't call it a fair test. Of course, that's easy to do. At least it's well-defined competition. But if your model is closer to real network, but it's it's not giving us what we want, then doesn't make any sense, right? So maybe I think with the story too, which I didn't tell, there was also the story that one of our students did. So the idea here was that Facebook just wanted to say, oh, let's see how your models behave. So Facebook, it was like 100 Facebook, I think, the data collection. So we had 100 networks on Facebook, different densities, different number of nodes, everything, you know, many different networks. And what they wanted to understand is that can you tell us what is the domination number? So the domination number is the smallest number of vertices, the smallest number of nodes, so that every single node is either in that set or is connected to that set. So they wanted to find the domination number, the smallest dominating set on Facebook. So that was their goal, and they said, you know, maybe your model could give us a good approximation. It could give us a good approximation for these guys. And then we come up with the model, prove the theorem that tells us, oh, if you have that density, if you have this power law degree distribution, if you have this number of nodes, then the domination number is asymptotic to blah. And then we use this as a black box, so all we got from them is the number of nodes, the number of edges, and the power law degree distribution, and we put those three numbers to our model, and then come up with a number that it's a good number for the model we were using, and then we compare this with them, and I don't remember, that was a long time ago, but I think this is the prediction of the model, and then where is the real thing? The real thing, I guess, is the top one, so. So as you see, it's not perfect, but it's at least, you know, we are kind of following the shape. So I guess they call it success in some sense. So just by these three parameters fitting into the model, we can tell something about the domination number for Facebook. So I don't know, it's maybe it's nothing, but that's kind of the spirit we want to do. We don't want to be perfect, because coming back to your question, what if this model is bad because I have to tweak a lot of things to make it perfect? But if it gives me a good number, good prediction, then I think my model is better than yours, even if yours is closer in an edit distance.